That. Okay, so let's start. So this is technically the last lecture in your 3 week long workshop. So, and I think it'll be a lot of fun. So these are some of my favorite topics. This is what I do majority of my own research on, and I hope you will have fun listening to it. So there are many variations possible on the flux balance theme. Right. And obviously, the variations stem from the variation in the objective function, variation in the kind of perturbation you want to make, and so on and so forth. And there's like a very large variety, which is sort of represents this beautiful figure. Right? People make really fancy, nice pictures, and this is what they call the phylogeny of constraint-based methods. So there's a very large universe of constraint-based modeling techniques. So you understand what's a constraint-based modeling technique, right? So anything that involves this SV equal to zero kind of constraint, other constraints on the bounds and so on and so forth, right? So flux balance analysis itself, there's some geometric FBA, FVA, Bayesian FBA, flux coupling, so on. With biological constraints, then gene deletion design, we'll talk about at least some of these. Gene perturbation, strain design, reaction addition, reaction perturbation, model refinement, gap filling, thermodynamics, regulatory methods, looking just at regulatory mechanisms versus looking at constraints from ohmic data, then, elementary flux modes and so on, and sampling for alternate optima, things like that. Heart of all of this is some stoichiometric matrix, right? So, if any of you are, is anybody actually working with constraint-based techniques? Yeah, only you, yeah. So if, so usually, when I show the slide, I want to know if somebody would like to particularly know about something, I go and talk about it. Otherwise, we'll try to come back to it. If I finish a little early, I'll show the slide again and you can, if anything appears interesting to you, you can ask me and I'll let you know if I remember what that technique is. Okay. The first interesting technique, which was way back in 2002, was the technique known as minimization of metabolic adjustment. So in FBA1, the major stumbling block in FBA is the need for an objective function. How do you come up with a sensible objective function? And will this objective function be always sensible? So if you are knocking down reactions in an organism, there's a guarantee that the organism is still trying to maximize its growth. It may just be trying to survive. They're saying, no, maximize growth again, right? So what Daniel Segre and others said was, maybe the organism is just trying to minimize the adjustment of its metabolism, right? So he says that the organism adapts by minimizing the changes from the wild type flux. So let's just see that a little more closely in a moment. It avoids the maximum growth objective for perturbations, right? So what is FBA again? I saw somebody had discussed over T about the C vector. I probably hadn't explained that clearly enough. So max C into V. This is just, C dot product of CV, right? Such that yep. Everybody is clear with this, right? How would you set up this formulation? Let's say this is FBA. And this gives you a solution, a V wild type. How would you set up the MoMA formulation, as it's called? Minimize the changes from the wild type flux. You're all math folks, should be easy for you. minimize what? I can always write the such that. How would you minimize the distance from, I already gave you the clue, the distance from the white type flux? It doesn't matter, you can also square it. What does this translate to? This is no longer a linear program. It's a quadratic program. What's the canonical form? So the canonical form of a linear program is minimize C transpose X such that for quadratic it is minimize or maximize . So what does this translate to? Just put a half, doesn't matter. Right? So now, what is H? What is H? Identity matrix. And C is? V wild type. Straightforward, right? Basic. I see some quizzical faces. What's not clear? There's nothing here, so I just inserted an identity matrix here. Sorry, here. I am ignoring this. It's just some large positive quantity. Some positive quantity, which I don't care about. So this is VD into VD, right? So I'm just putting an identity matrix here. I mean, why do we even care about an identity matrix? That's because what happens if I have only a set of fluxes that have been measured? Suppose I could measure 20 fluxes in experimentally, right? How would I set up the objective function? So let me explain the problem to you again. So what is it that we've been working on so far? So in the morning we saw flux balance analysis. The next step was, we said, flux balance analysis always necessitates the use of an objective function which may not always be fair to the cell. You can't ask the cell to maximize its growth when you're, you know, harassing it by doing gene deletions and so on. So you say you try to minimize the metabolic adjustment. Minimize from what? Minimize what you would have been growing as a wild-type cell. And now you stay as close as possible you can to that, but complying with your new constraints. In fact, I missed a constraint here, which is reactions being deleted. I actually preempted it. I should have asked you before. How do you go about deleting reactions from a model? The simplest idea would be, or the naive idea would be, discard the row corresponding to that from the stoichiometric matrix. But turns out that's actually more work, because you can just say v1 equal to 0 or v2 equal to 0 as an additional constraint. Right? You initially have constraints like alpha I less than va less than beta I. Instead, you just go ahead and say a particular vi equals 0. Right? That means the reaction is deleted. The reaction cannot carry flux. Right? So under that case, we are trying to minimize the metabolic adjustment in this fashion, which translates to this. So if you want to use, I think there might be a quad prog in some of your MATLABs at least. Right? So the inputs for quad prog would be these. Vivek, what's your question? Yeah. So where do you get the wild type vector from? That's his question. Right? Presumably we get that from FBA. Wild type flux, we simulate it and get it using FBA. Because we're kind of in agreement from the previous hour that FBA gives you good predictions for wild type flux. What we are saying is that FBA may not give you as good predictions for perturbation flux, deletions, deletion phenotypes and so on. Right, where the objective function of growth maximization may no longer be really tenable. So what if I have some... So now, to answer your question, to extend your question, if I actually had experimental measurements, I might as well use them. I don't need to use the wild-type flux. But what if I didn't have complete experimental measurements and I had it only for, say, 50 fluxes, 20 fluxes, right? Then what you would normally do, what would you normally do? You want to fit some fluxes to your model. How would you do any fitting? Least squares, right? So you would say, minimize sigma VDI minus VMI, I belonging to some measured set. Squared, is that correct? That's what you would do. If you look at this carefully, this is identical to this. Except that instead of the I matrix, we will have a matrix which looks like this. Corresponding to your set M. Right? Because then, you know, if you use this matrix, you would essentially get one part of this. And this is going to be, all these will give you zeros for the unmeasured fluxes. And it'll be, you can just do the algebra and check it out. So this is very useful. Because oftentimes, people run experiments. So coming back to the biology, how would you estimate fluxes in a cell? Sorry? Labeling. You have to label. Right? So you put in some C13 carbon, C13 glucose, and then you start, or C14 glucose, right? Depending on the case, and then you start tracking. Right? If you have, so you can use different types of glucose. Right? You can have uniformly labeled glucose. Every carbon is labeled. Or only first carbon is labeled. Only second carbon is labeled. Whatever. Right? And you know that glucose becomes pyruvate, which has only three carbons. So if you have one mole of carbon 1 labeled glucose, you will get one mole of unlabeled pyruvate and one mole of carbon labeled pyruvate, C13 pyruvate, right? So that's going to tell you how much, that's not going to tell you much, but you know, then the pyruvate goes into something else and glucose 6-phosphate goes into something else. You can start tracing. you finally do this metabolic flux analysis. That's usually called C13 MFA, metabolic flux analysis. You don't actually do a flux balance. Right? You don't assume an objective function. You don't do any of those things. You essentially track basically lots of simultaneous equations saying, fill in the blanks. I have so much here, what was in between? No, can you predict what is the flux here? I had C13 glucose, labeled glucose here. I have some label concentration here, some label concentration here. What are my internal fluxes, right? So that is how you go about measuring your fluxes. And these measured fluxes can be used to better fit data. Right? So the first thing you may want to check is if you curate a model and there are some measured fluxes available, you want to see if you can actually fit those data. If you can't, then there's some constraint off in your model. In fact, we uncovered certain constraints like that when we were working with, we were trying to model sunflower. And we found out that some reactions were in the wrong direction and so on because it could never fit some of our experimental measurements, some of the published experimental measurements. Okay, so let me just recap. So you do minimize V wild type minus VD. What is this geometrically? Right. And now you're saying that you have a new variation. So you look at sort of distances from that. You minimize the distance from this flux. So let's say your new constraint gave you this. So you want to find out this point, which is closest in space from the original point. This is, let's say, V wild type. You want to find VD such that this distance is minimized. Clear? Good. Yeah. So the canonical form is half VD transpose I into VD plus minus wild type dot VD such that SVD equal to 0. There's another technique. Somebody else said, why do we minimize the distance? Instead, can you minimize the number of the amount of rerouting that occurs? So what happens from VD to VW to VD? We can study some of these things in the afternoon. You will see that many fluxes will change. Right? We are trying to change it in such a way that we keep the two fluxes as close as possible. Right? But what Shlomi and others suggested is don't keep the fluxes close, keep the number of fluxes that are similar close. So, for example, let's say you have VW is, very simplistically speaking, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1. Right? And VD is 1.9.9.9.9.9.9. Right? Then you will compute the distance between these two as, you know, 0.05 or something like that. Right? But what Shlomi says is, instead, can you find a flux that minimizes the number of changes? So you have 1.8.8.1 or something. This is going to be 0.04, I think, but no. Something that has fewer reactions that are changing, right? Because if you have to change every reaction by some delta, you have to go and manipulate so many enzymes. Not happening in the cell. Too much of work for the cell. But if you have a minimum number of rerouting, there are only, you have to just instruct 10 enzymes to change their behavior, right? Then it's easier for the cell to do a minimal rerouting, right? But broadly speaking, what is it that we are trying to do? We are actually trying to again guess what the cell is trying to do. We initially guessed the cell is trying to maximize its growth. Now we are guessing that the cell is trying to minimize its adjustment or minimize the number of reroutings or whatever. Right? And obviously you will see that some of these each of these techniques is useful in certain cases. So one observation is that, MoMA, the quadratic programming technique that we studied previously, is better at predicting transient changes. So initially, the cell tries to do a lot of change, but finally it settles down in a place where, which is better predicted by room, where most of the reactions are identical to the original. I've readjusted to the original steady state, but a bunch of reactions have now been completely routed. Fair enough? Yeah. Mathematically, this turns out to be a mixed integer linear programming problem. You can probably, you know, go through the paper. There's this Shlomi 2005 PNAS paper. If you want, I can share those papers with you, but I think it's now open access. It's so old. So basically, you end up with these equations may look a little challenging, hopefully not to most of you because you have a strong math background, but actually some translates to something very simple, right? If you have yi is 1, then this only means v max less than greater than equal to v and v min less than equal to v, which is your these constraints, alpha, v, beta, lower bound, upper bound constraints. So you basically minimize, so here you don't minimize the fluxes, you minimize the number of significant flux changes. So in fact, in this example is probably not very good because you may not consider any of these changes to be significant. But you basically have few fluxes that change by a large amount. Many fluxes can change by a small amount. Whereas in MoMA, many fluxes might change. So I'll try to talk about this a little later because this is something we've recently observed very clearly. So MoMA involves a lot of rerouting. We were trying to study compensation by equal enzymes and things like that. So what kind of rerouting happens when you delete one reaction versus the other? Two reactions that can fill in for one another. And it turns out that MoMA predicts a solution that involves so much more rerouting than something like room. This is not too difficult, right? Okay. Great. It's actually simple. Yeah. So they say MoMA predicts the transient metabolic states and predicts better transient growth rates, whereas room predicts the steady state post-adaptation and so on. And this is a sort of visual representation of the same. This is linear programming. You have, in all cases, if you see, you have linear constraints. The constraints are linear, right? Your objective function could be different depending upon the case. Here is a linear objective function. Here you have a quadratic objective function because the quadratic objective function is distance from this. Here you have a nonlinear objective function. And here your solutions have to be integers. And they have to lie on the grid. Grid is integers, so mixed integer. So some can be on the grid, some can be anywhere. Okay. So now, yeah. 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 So that's essentially what MoMA and room predict. So MoMA tries to, the quadratic programming method tries to predict the initial change. The moment you do a deletion, everything tries to change and all that. And then finally you settle down into a nice steady state where most of the things are as before, as normal. A few reactions have been forced to rewrite because there was no other choice. Because you deleted some reaction which the cell was previously using. So room kind of better predicts the final state, whereas, you know, the transient growth rates are better predicted by the quadratic programming method. So what kind of perturbations can you do? We were talking about, you can do deletions or additions or overexpression, right? So addition is straightforward. You may have to add another column to the stoichiometric matrix or something like that. And deletion, you might want to remove a column, but instead of that, it's even easier if you were to just set something to zero. No big deal. Right, you can just say V1 equal to zero, means reaction is deleted. It's an addition. You set both the lower and upper bounds to zero. That's what you do in a simulation. Okay. So I've already told you that a fundamental philosophy of systems biology is that you want to study and understand biological systems and networks through perturbations. Right? Remove a component, remove multiple components, remove a pair of components, what happens? Right? And typically removal or overexpression of genes, and you can simulate the effect of such changes in genotype and predict the phenotype by using techniques such as FBA, MoMA, Room, and so on. And the ability to analyze alternate genotypes or strains is of immense importance in, say, metabolic engineering or drug target identification. What is the exact set of genes you need to knock out to kill an organism? Or what is the set of genes you want to overexpress or knock out to overproduce something? So you want to turn off some pathway so that more succinate can be produced, more ethanol can be produced. How do you reroute the traffic within the cell so that? And overexpression is like, which road do I widen in the cell? Right, so that more traffic goes through. These are some of the common questions that one asks. So for metabolic engineering, we are primarily interested in overproducing something or whatever. For drug target identification, it's usually the inverse thing. You want to shut down something. Here you want better efficiency, there you want zero efficiency in some sense. You want like zero performance. Right? You want to identify proteins which have a major negative effect on the pathogen. There are other methods also, you know, non-flux-based methods. So people have used like load points and choke points in metabolic networks. So in fact, using centrality measures. So centrality itself, this is something we were trying the other day, right? I told you to knock out the top 10 nodes and figure out how the network responds and so on. And also using machine learning by, you know, taking a lot of features and learning what feature, what kind of proteins are actually more central and so on. But here we are obviously trying to study the metabolic network itself and trying to figure out if this network cannot grow under certain perturbations. Right? So essentially the maximum growth rate of a network is zero when you delete a gene, which means it's a lethal phenotype. Right? Or for overexpression, you want to see if it can perform better, produce more of your compound of interest and so on. So any of the constraint-based approaches, gene deletions are simply done by altering the constraints on one or more reactions. Right? So typically, we'll set the upper and lower bound of these reactions to zero. Following the change in constraints, you can again simulate using one of these techniques. But if you're worried, if you are doing metabolic engineering, you need to also look at the growth rate. Right? In metabolic engineering, you have two issues. So somebody once said this is the life of a cell, right? And this is the life of a metabolic engineer. Right? You want the cell actually tries to push S to X, whereas you have to somehow push S to P. Right? But if you totally push this off, then the cell stops growing, that's also not good. Right? So you need to have some growth and good product. So you need overall, you know, yield or productivity to be reasonably good. Right? So as you go and delete genes, you need to watch the growth rate as well. You delete genes or reactions from a model. The unit of model is reaction, the unit of biology is gene. You have to kind of make sense of the two, right? Because finally, you're never going to go to a biologist and say, delete these reactions, the system is going to be better, or, you know, it's going to produce more of ethanol or whatever. You have to go back to a gene deletion. But then, you know, they are interchangeable because we have what's known as gene-protein reaction relationships. So that's what I was trying to allude to in the morning. Very important, it's straightforward. But let's say you have a gene, succinate dehydrogenase A, another gene, succinate dehydrogenase B. This codes for the protein SDHA, this codes for the protein SDHB. And together, so after this, they could either be isozymes, which means this can catalyze R1, this can also catalyze R1, or they could form a multi-enzyme complex which catalyzes R1, or it could catalyze R1 and R2. So there is a many-to-many relationship between genes, proteins, and reactions. So let's look at a simple example. Let's say G1 is catalyzed by, R1 is catalyzed by G1 or G2. R2 is catalyzed by G1 and G2. R3 is catalyzed by G2 and G3. For simplicity, I'll just keep right. So how would you delete the reaction R1? G1 and G2 have to be zero. Right? If you delete G1 and G2, then R1 goes out. Right? But let's say, and if you want to delete R2, you'll have to delete G2 and G3. But if you delete G1, G2, G3, you will also end up removing R3. Right? So there is no way to actually delete R3 alone. You can do that with G1. So, but you know, if now let's take a slightly different example. Now if you remove G1 or G3, this will go out. But if you remove G1 or G3, R1 or R2 will go out. So there's no way to delete R3 from the system. Right? So reaction deletion strategies may not make sense. Suppose you say delete R3. No biologist can ever delete R3. The biologist can delete R1, R2, R3. No problem. There's no way to delete just R3, because for that, the manipulation you need to perform to do that is going to involve the loss of some other genes. You have a question, or? Depends. So if it is G1 and G2, you require both of them. If it is G1 or G2, you require either of them. So this is like an isozyme, this is like a multi-enzyme complex. So think of this as your SDH AB that I wrote here. And this could just be, you know, SDHA. Let's say something else, no? Let's say PGAA or PGAB. Some make up some enzymes. Yeah, you have a question? So this is, so by a gene network, we usually talk about the relationship between the genes, right? Yeah, you need to know. So this is actually a very important step of the metabolic network reconstruction, right? We are not asking for what gene regulates what gene and all that, but the correspondence between genes, proteins, and reactions needs to be known. So in terms of wet lab, the unit of deletion will be genes. And it's also possible to delete reactions. But note that, as I've already explained, the relationship between genes, proteins, and reactions is never one-to-one. So you can have isozymes, or you can have substrate promiscuity. The same gene can actually catalyze 10 reactions. Right? So you can never remove R1. You can either remove R1 to R10 or remove nothing. Right? So consequently, the removal of a reaction may require deletion of multiple genes and may accompany the removal of additional reactions. I've already explained these concepts to you. And a strategy with the minimum number of reaction deletions may not correspond to a strategy with the minimum number of gene deletions. That's again obvious. Yeah. For example, there are 4 serine deaminases in E. coli. So we have to remove the serine deamination reaction. We have to knock out 4 genes. This is probably a lot more work and a lot more stress for the cell. Okay. Any questions?
Why all those things are not top in terms of genes?
Of all what things?
So instead of using the reactants, why not we are using genes as a reactant kind of thing to carry out?
Oh, so you're saying, you know, you can say A plus B plus G1 giving something like that, or?
Yeah, something like
that. But the problem is, you know, they're all catalysts, right? So how do you actually put them into reactions? So A plus B plus G1 will give you C plus G plus D plus G1. So it's, there's like no balance that you can do on that or anything of that sort.
Then it will be one more step ahead, then we have to check how many genes will be related.
Yeah. So it's another layer. So you have to always look at that layer. And so you have a gene layer, a protein layer, a reaction layer. And gene and protein aren't a big deal for us. It's practically equivalent for us. Except, you know, SDHAB could be a protein, right? Which involves gene, SDHA gene and SDHB gene. So, so if you want to read, there is a... There's an overwhelming and well-written paper by I think it is 2009 in Nature Methods, 9 or 11, I'm not sure. So a protocol for generating a high-quality genome-scale reconstruction, and it outlines 96 steps that have to be done in a reconstruction. So moral of the story is, you know, hope that somebody gives you a model and asks you to simulate and not build a model from scratch. It's a lot of effort, right? And you have to be on top of the biology as well. And which is why it has to be done in large interdisciplinary groups. It's quite hard to... And you should also look up some of Arijit's work on reconstruction. And Neurospora has published, or... Oh, it's in bioarchive, yeah. Well, that's like really good. So they've done a very nice reconstruction of Neurospora crassa, integrating multiple data sets and, you know, putting probabilities for different evidences. And it's a slightly different take on reconstruction. It's like quite nice. Okay. This is a very nice technique that's used to study overexpression. And I particularly like this technique because it very nicely imbibes the philosophy of flux balance analysis. Right? As I kept mentioning in the morning, the most important thing to remember about flux balance is you do not have one solution. You have multiple solutions. But what is reliable from the FBA is actually the objective function growth rate. Objective function value or growth rate is actually reliable. So let's consider a classic metabolite, which is non-growth associated. I hope you remember those terms from yesterday, right? So something that's not produced while biomass is produced, like what I have there. S can go to X, or you can withdraw it from X and push it towards P, right? In that case, if you maximize biomass, the product yield will be lower. If you maximize product, biomass yield will be lower. Right. So this is the scenario. The question is, what roads do I widen in the metabolic network? Which reactions should I push more flux through, or in other words, overexpress? Which enzymes, genes do I overexpress so that I get more product? Ethanol, lycopene, succinate, whatever. Some of these might be growth associated, but you know, lycopene won't be. Secondary metabolites are usually not growth associated. So the idea is, what they suggested is, you first carry out a simulation, max product. So essentially, you know, maximize V bio such that SV equal to 0, alpha, beta, whatever. And let's say you get a value, 1.3 millimole right? And now maximize V product. Such that same thing. And let's say you get some value 0.7. Something of this sort. And what they said is, you know, now we make a table, essentially. So you have V bio and V product. So this is 1.30. I'm saying it's not growth associated. So if you push more flux towards, maybe this is some epsilon and not zero. Okay, I'll put epsilon. Right. But what they suggested is, you now increase from zero to max product in small steps. See how biomass increases, decreases, right? Biomass will decrease. But the important thing is, what kind of rerouting is happening from this scenario to this scenario to this finally? So if you take any reaction, it'll have one of the behaviors that you see in the bottom. This is the most boring behavior, right? The reaction remains same. You increase biomass, decrease biomass, this reaction is agnostic. It doesn't move. There are some reactions, as you increase product, they decrease in flux. There are some reactions, as you increase product, they increase in flux. Understand? So what we do is, we step by step increase product flux, but the objective function is biomass maximization, because that is what the cell invariably tries to do, right? So if you keep increasing product flux, so how do you do this? You say that product equals so much. You add that as a constraint and then simulate, which means biomass cannot hit maximum. If you say product is zero, biomass can hit maximum. But if you say product is 50%, biomass can only go to 40% or 60% or whatever, 50%. So, in the step-by-step-by-step analysis, you see that some reactions are always increasing as you increase product flux. Some reactions are always decreasing as you increase product flux. So, the idea that these guys gave was, those reactions that are admitting more flux as you increase product are the ones you may want to widen first. And we've actually had success with this. I mean, they also reported success with this, and we did this for sunflower and we got experimentally good results. And how do you now pick the best perturbation? So is there some way you want to rank the perturbations? So one idea that's suggested is, what are the V biomass V biomass overexpression with respect to V biomass wild type into V product overexpression by V product wild type? You get some 20% loss here and some 20% gain here. What's the overall picture? This may be a way to rank your perturbations. And you can obviously cascade you can join your perturbations. You can do overexpress multiple genes and compute this and so on. I only told you what is the strategy to overexpress. How do you actually do the overexpression in the model? In the model. Organism, I leave it to the biologist. How do you overexpress in the model? Deletion was easy. Say VD equal to V5 equal to 0, deleted, done. Yeah, so there are different strategies. So you can increase the lower bound, you can pin the flux. That's what I was essentially trying to do here, right? So I pinned the product flux to something. I didn't overexpress yet, this was just the product flux. But let's say you have a wild type distribution and that gives you some value for reaction phi. It gives you V5 is 10.3. You now say force V5 equals 20.6. Now that is 100% overexpression. And then you rerun the simulation. You throw in an additional constraint of this sort and rerun the simulation and you hopefully have a, you know, better solution. You have a something that tries to predict what happens when you overexpress. Just changing the bound, change the lower bound, yes, will. But if you just change the upper bound or something, it's not going to make a difference. So that reaction may not be saturated. Is that clear? Okay. So now let's move to synthetic lethals. This is again, you know, quite interesting and it's my own favorite. So what are synthetic lethals? Does anybody know? Biology folks? No, but what is synthetic lethal? What's a lethal? Knockout which kills the organism, right? We want to identify lethal genes. And you know, some of the lethal genes could be prioritized as drug targets, whatever, and so on. So what's a synthetic lethal? It's a pair of genes, which when you knock out, will kill the organism. When you individually knock out one of the genes, it doesn't do anything. So here we have two genes, ABC and PQR. When you knock out PQR, nothing happens. When you knock out ABC, the cell still grows. When you knock out ABC and PQR, the organism dies. Why? Maybe they were isozymes. Maybe they were somehow producing metabolites that were compensating for one another, and so on. It's called synthetic because you synthetically combine the two. A and B, you synthetically combine this deletion. Anybody has heard of synthetic lethal in cancer therapy? And by the way, you can extend synthetic lethals to higher order. And at level of 3, you delete AB, nothing happens. BC, nothing happens. AC, nothing happens. But if you delete ABC, the organism dies. It means that there is some gene interaction, some subtle gene interaction that's going on between a pair, triplet, or whatever of genes. So synthetic lethals find applications in gene function and functional associations. Combinatorial drug targets against pathogens. There's a very classic paper which I think from Peter Sermeli's group in Hungary, I don't remember which group. Multiple weak hits can confuse complex networks. That's the title of the paper, right? So instead of strong hits, multiple weak hits can be even more damaging to a network. There's still a bit of debate and the cells are very smart and there's a lot of, uncertainty about this. But if you look at any classic drug, it targets an essential gene in the organism, an essential protein. So what happens is there's a strong selective pressure to adapt to that gene, to that drug, to the loss of that gene, right? But whereas if you are targeting, you can target multiple essential genes, which obviously puts a stronger, it's harder for the organism to make multiple adaptations. But if you were to instead target two non-essential genes, two individually non-essential but jointly essential genes, right? In that case, the selective pressure is actually low. There is no reward to, mutate to that gene. Although one mutation is already going to rescue the organism, there is no immediate reward to the one mutation, right? So there's a potential for this to make it harder for the cell to develop resistance, right? And in cancer therapy, anyone's heard of synthetic lethals in cancer therapy? Why would synthetic lethals be important in cancer? The advantage is that See, most cancer cells have a have some malfunction, right? So some gene is overexpressed, some gene is underexpressed, or something like that. So if there is a gene that is already deleted in a cancer cell, right, which has led to the cancer, and you target the other, you know, its synthetic lethal counterpart, then only the cancer cell will die, not the healthy cell. Because a healthy cell, suppose A and B are synthetic lethal, cancer cells lack A. You go and delete B from all cells and, you know, you put a drug that targets B. Normal cells are going to survive because they have A. Cancer cells are going to die because they neither have A nor have B. Right? So, synthetic lethals are of interest in cancer as well. But not to say that, you know, you can use metabolic network simulations to identify synthetic lethals. It's really not that straightforward. So this only gives you but a small part of the synthetic lethals within the cell, right? There are many synthetic lethals within a cell, but here we'll, using FBA and so on, we can only study those which are involved in metabolism. So how do you identify synthetic lethals? Experimentally, people have used genetic arrays and so on. And there have obviously been in silico approaches, but using flux balance analysis. But and of course, they are restricted to metabolic genes. Single lethals are easy to identify. We'll do that in the afternoon. What you do is, you solve one optimization problem for every single lethal. You delete gene 1, compute. Delete gene 2, run an FBA. Delete gene 3, run an FBA. Delete gene N, do an FBA. So you'll get the phenotype for each of these. Usually we say that if the growth rate is less than 5% of the original growth rate, it is lethal. Or you can say if growth rate is zero, then it is lethal. Or if growth rate is less than 50%, it's lethal. It's really going to affect the organism. Synthetic lethals are harder to identify. How do you identify synthetic lethals? For I equals 1 to n, for j equals 1 to n. Right? So you are basically doing n choose 2. Right? How do you identify synthetic triple lethals? N choose 3. Right? And if you have about 1,000 genes, N choose 3 is about 170 million. Right? Good luck doing those simulations on your laptop. Right? And even on a supercomputer, really. It's going to be very challenging. Right? Yeah. So instead, what people did is they changed the formulation to an MILP kind of formulation. Now by slightly altering the formulation by saying, find the number of knockouts that minimize, keep the number of knockouts as 2, and, you know, constrain the system so that it cannot grow. Right? So it translates to a mixed integer linear programming problem. I don't want to get into the details, but you can look up there's a paper by Sudhas and Plas, Computational Biology, in 2009. It's from Costas Maranas' group in Pittsburgh, I think. So they basically have a bi-level MILP, and they've studied synthetic lethal double and triple reaction deletions. The problem is the MILP problems get incrementally difficult to solve. Right? You start with one MILP, it gives you a solution. How you find the next double gene deletion is that you add a constraint saying, don't give me the first one. I don't want the first solution that you give. So incrementally, the problem size expands and the convergence becomes poorer and so on. And they took about, 1 week to identify lethals in E. coli. Right? Although there's another method which is, again, based on MILP, but it's much faster. So here they do other optimizations, such as compressing the linear pathways and things like that. And they actually perform very well. And I think they take about maybe an hour or so to compute the lethals instead of a week, right? And we asked this question, is there a way to surmount the complexity of exhaustive enumeration, right? That's very difficult. You need a big cluster or something to run those computations. And the poor convergence of mixed integer linear programming, is there a way to get around it? So we came up with an algorithm that basically exploits the search, the way the search space is, and eliminates several computations. So instead of performing n choose 3 or n choose 2 simulations, we would do one 10,000th of those, 1,000th of those. Right? And that led to major savings. So for E. coli, we actually got a search space saving of nearly 4,000-fold. And we identified triple lethals in about 8 minutes, right? Which is compared to the weeks that the older method was taking. And other method takes about 15, 20 minutes or so. And I'm not getting into the details. If somebody is interested, we can, you know, talk right after the talk or something like that. So we use a couple of interesting hacks. We use what's known as a minimal norm solution to FBA. There are multiple solutions for FBA possible. I think all of you are convinced of that by now. But there is one very sparse solution to FBA, which is like, you know, drive as many reactions to zero as possible, but continue to grow. The cell will, by normal, use multiple sets of reactions or something like that. For example, you can take a very long pathway to produce something. Right? But you could take an alternative pathway which is like much shorter. And even if you were to drive flux through there, the cell is still going to grow. Which means that actually none of these reactions may be essential. So we used some of those ideas to cut down the search space, and we got like massive savings. And yeah, it's available online if you want to go. So what can genome scale metabolic networks tell us? I didn't use this term before, I think. Genome scale, so like very large genome scale metabolic networks. There's also, you know, people use these terms interchangeably, but technically you have genome scale metabolic model and genome scale metabolic network. Network is just your reconstruction. Model includes all the constraints and other things you've added on top of that. Right, you have additional constraints for lower bound, upper bound, and things like that. This is a very nice picture again. So it summarizes back in 2013 or so, what are the different kinds of studies that were done just using the E. coli reconstruction. You know, hundreds of models have been reconstructed to date, but E. coli remains one of the most popular models. And there are many different applications. So if you see, metabolic engineering studies are 25% plus. So nearly 1/4 of the studies involve metabolic engineering, and another 1/4 of the study involve prediction of cellular phenotypes, which is again, you know, somewhat towards metabolic engineering. What happens when you remove this? What happens when you add that? What happens when you remove something else? And then some theoretical studies of metabolic network properties. 1/3 of the studies involve, you know, analysis of biological network properties, what reactions are coupled, what reactions are correlated, so on. And then studies of evolutionary processes, interactions between different species, and so on. So this is something we are looking at in our lab as well, and it's quite challenging and exciting at the same time. So any questions so far? So following this, I'll just give you some applications of metabolic of flux balance analysis and so on. So all the math and the modeling is kind of done with this. Any questions, any lingering doubts on any of the techniques we've discussed so far? You mean experimentally? Experimentally, yeast is the favorite. I know there's a lot of work in yeast. I'm not very sure about other organisms. I'm sure there's probably something for E. coli and so on. But yeast is, you know, a lot of work has been done with yeast. Multiple synthetic genetic arrays and have been used to. And the accuracy is like, you know, usually reasonable. Right? So FBA is about, in general, about 85-90% accurate with respect to phenotype predictions. And in fact, that's something I need to discuss as well before we get into the applications. Can you now really get thinking? You have a model and you have an experiment, right? Right? So I could just write this as just Growth, no growth. So the model may say there is no growth, but the experiment may say there is growth. The model says there is growth, experiment says there is growth. Nice. True positive. Model says no growth, experiment says no growth. True negative, no problem. What about true false positives and false negatives? Why do they arise? So first, let's consider model says there is no growth, but experiment says there is growth. Why does this arise? So kind of put the FBA pipeline into your head and see why the model is going to say something different from what the experiment says. Where are all the places that things could go wrong? So if you are doing some research in constraint-based analysis, this is the place to start. Right? Why does something go wrong? Sure, right? Many a time when you run your simulations, be it ODEs or whatever, you invariably get some absurd results. And that's where you end up learning a lot. What has a limiting range value? No, what I'm saying is the model says that there is no growth, whereas the experiment says that there is growth. So why is the model under-predicting? What could be a reason? It's the first place to start, right? Garbage in, garbage out. The reconstruction is not correct. But what could you have missed in the reconstruction? Yeah, so there could be multiple reasons for this, right? There could be, some important reactions that have been missed out, or some additional, some reactions you think are not there but are actually there. Right, so the cell is able to grow. So some parallel reaction. So let's say succinate dehydrogenase example we had. SDHA is there in your model, but B is not there. So when you remove SDHA, model says there's no growth. But in reality, there's SDHB, there is growth. Right? What are the other scenarios that can happen? What happens when the model says there is growth, but the experiment says there is no growth? So there's something wrong with your constraint. There are many gaps in the model, right? There is some essential metabolite that you've not even included in your objective function, right? So actually your objective function is satisfied. In reality, the objective function is not satisfied. The cellular objective is not satisfied. Your objective function is satisfied, right? So that's a possibility. And then what happens, for example, when you have isozymes that are not created equal. Many a time, see, from a model perspective, you say G1 or G2 can catalyze reaction R1. But in reality, G1 can do a much better job of catalyzing R1 than G2. Right? So when you delete G1, the cell nearly dies off. Whereas, the model may not capture that. So these kinds of issues exist. And what happens when a gene has a non-metabolic function? So you delete G1, it doesn't have a metabolic, an essential metabolic function. So the model will tell you that, what will the model tell you if the gene is non-essential? There is growth. But in reality, there'll be no growth because the model had the gene had a non-metabolic essential function. It's maybe, important in maintaining the structure. What else can tell you, give you growth in the model, but no growth experimentally? What are the first assumption in FBA? Where do we start? Steady state, and therefore means no accumulation. What if some metabolite is accumulating in the cell? You can't model that, and that could be toxic to the cell, and that could be another reason for it not growing. Plus, FBA will say, tell you that it doesn't... You can include those things. Depending upon which gene is active, you can change the upper and lower bounds, for example. So if G1 is a better catalyst for the reaction, you can give it a higher upper bound than when you use G2. That will automatically constrain the growth rates and so on. So in fact, there are techniques. So, while at this, I can also briefly talk about regulation. Right? I'm not a big fan. Vivek is a big fan. You can ask him. He's written a paper about many of these techniques. But there are two families of regulatory techniques. If you go back to the... There are two families of regulatory techniques. You have constraints from omic data and actual regulatory mechanisms, right? I'm myself a fan of actual regulatory mechanisms, right? Because it gives you a first principles insight into the cell. But obviously, painstaking reconstruction. Nobody's ever going to reconstruct such a model for you. And it turns out the existing reconstruction models are also not great. Right. So in fact, we could never reproduce the classic regulatory flux balance analysis results at all after multiple rounds of struggling with it. So what we find is, so RFBA is a technique wherein you put Boolean constraints. If G1 is there and V1 is high, shut off G2. Which is, if glucose is there and, glucose flux is very high, then shut off lactose uptake. Then you can actually get a proper dioxic shift when you grow on a medium containing glucose plus lactose and so on. So there is some dynamics here. So because you are responding to flux values or gene expression levels and so on, right? So how would you simulate this? You initially start with a given regulatory state and you run an FBA. You will get a metabolic state. You take that metabolic state and compute your rules. You can have rules for gene expression. When G1 is high, G2 is low. G2 is high, G3 is low. Because this inhibits this, this represses this, this activates the other gene. So you can iteratively compute regulatory and metabolic states. So from one regulatory state, compute a metabolic state. From that metabolic state, go to another regulatory state, and so on. So this is much like you would see in a Boolean network or something like that. You can have an attractor, you can reach a steady state, and all those things. The other idea is to, of course, integrate genomic data. And one nice technique is called efflux, which basically just constrains the bounds of reactions by using the... GPR relations, right? If a particular gene reaction can be catalyzed by G1 or G2, it takes the maximum of those two values as the upper bound. If it has to be catalyzed by G1 and G2, it takes the minimum of those values, essentially on these lines. So it uses, and these expression values are obtained from literature, microarray data that have been reported in different repositories and so on. So I'll go back to some of my PhD work done way back in here in Bangalore in IISc. So we looked at flux balance analysis to predict drug target in tuberculosis. So I don't have to emphasize the importance of tuberculosis in India especially. But the tuberculosis is a very interesting cell wall, which renders it impermeable to regular antibiotics and things like that. And particularly because of an interesting compound known as mycolic acid. Actually a family of compounds, alpha alkyl beta hydroxy fatty acids. So this was painstaking reconstruction, which one of my colleagues did. I helped along. But essentially, we ended up finding about 219 reactions involved in synthesis of these mycolates and about 28 proteins with 197 metabolites and 28 exchange fluxes. First question, what's the size of the stoichiometric matrix? It's not straightforward. You need to stare at it for a minute. Come on. 197 cross? to 247, right? You have 219 internal reactions and 28 exchange fluxes, right? So we got the model from cake, biopsych literature, simulated using FBA, MoMA, and so on. How do you write an objective function for a pathway? It's a lot harder, right? And you can't get very quantitative insights. The lethality insights might be useful, but there are no, I can't predict the growth rate of mycobacterium from this. I can say that when you delete INHA, the cell will die. That is okay. But, you know, I really can't tell you if, what will be the growth rate and so on. So this is something that we found. These are different flux distributions. So, if you look at the inset, these are the mycolate fluxes. And if you see, for a non-essential gene, there is a redistribution. Whereas for an essential gene, the cell is just killed. This is some inhibition. So, whereas, you know, this is similar to this, but the scale is very low. So, all reactions are throttled. Okay. So, what did we find? We found that we also compared with experimental data, and we got like about 19 agreements, 5 disagreements. Right? So, growth, and no growth, and growth, no growth, and no growth, growth here. And for 4, we didn't have any data. The MoMA results were very similar. So we then shortlisted targets based on other criteria and so on. I'll not get into the details here because I'm going to talk about it in the last set of slides. So you can actually, you know, if you want more clarity on FBA, you can go through this because we've like spelled out everything carefully in this paper. It's one of the very early papers on FBA for doing target identification. So how do you go ahead and use FBA for metabolic engineering? That's the other, or in fact, the more important application, most popular application of flux balance analysis. So here, there's a classic paper by Stephanopoulos and co-workers. You might remember the name from yesterday. So lycopene is a carotenoid found in tomatoes. So carotenes are basically, you know, long chain, unsaturated compounds. So they use as a food colorant and so on, and they have, lycopene is already being produced using engineered E. coli. So what these guys did was very cool. They took an overproducing strain, an already overproducing strain, did computational studies, re-engineered it, and produced 37% more lycopene, purely through, obviously computational predictions followed by experimental validation. So it produced more, 37% more lycopene. This is a lycopene pathway. There's glucose. It somewhere goes down to glyceraldehyde-3 phosphate, pyruvate. This is your glycolysis. From glycolysis, you have an offshoot which goes towards lycopene. So you can clearly see, right? You drive most of here, this suffers. If you drive most of here, lycopene production will suffer. So the initial simulations revealed that there's an inverse relationship between lycopene and growth, whereas a direct relationship between lycopene and glucose, right? Obviously, glucose is the raw material, but if you were to grow more, you're shutting off lycopene production. So you have to balance the two. How do you go and balance it? So what they did was they tried out multiple knockout studies. Right? Computational. They used flux balance analysis and MoMA to knock out every single gene from the organism. And, these are some of the results that they had. So they found that this ACE or PPC had, some yield. So the yield goes down. So you need high yield and reasonable growth rate, right? So this is the growth and this is the lycopene yield. So the single knockout scan predicted about 8 genes whose deletion yielded enhanced product synthesis while satisfying some minimal growth rate. Right. But then they wanted to do double knockouts as well. And double knockouts are very hard. Right. And in 2005, it was harder. Right. So actually, they did all double knockouts. Right? They wanted to also do triple knockouts, which is basically impossible. So what they did was they took the best double knockouts and did an additional single knockout on that. Right? That's like doing single knockouts in like 10 organisms or something, double knockouts in 10 organisms or something like that. Not too difficult. So these were some of the results. I already gave you some of these numbers. So they took the best, some of the single knockouts, and these are all from all double knockouts, but they took the best double knockouts and did an additional single knockout on that. So they finally found that some GDHA, ACE, and FDHF is very good, prediction-wise. And this table is nice. So if you see, there are even some predictions that went completely off. So remember, FBA has its limitations. But the good thing is, if you try a bunch of predictions, some of them are more or less guaranteed to work because the technique is generally very robust. Right? And we actually got quite lucky with FBA in two different organisms, with sunflower and Lactococcus lactis, where we've been able to overproduce vitamin E in sunflower and hyaluronic acid in Lactococcus lactis purely through, you know, FBA-based simulations, which predicted what genes to re-engineer or delete and so on. So if you see, the final value that they got is 37% overproduction. The growth rate is not too bad. It is about, you know, 2/3 of the original growth rate. Little less than 2/3. So overall, the experimental results followed the trends. Obviously, in some cases, they went the opposite direction. And it emphasized the potential of metabolic network models. And of course, if you were to integrate regulatory information, it would be much better. But it's a challenge that people are still addressing. You may want to even integrate signaling, so on and so forth. It, finally, they had a 37% overproducing strain. So last thing that I want to talk to you is one of our approaches called Target TB. So what we did is we integrated, made a full-blown systems-level pipeline to predict drug targets. How would you use systems biology to predict drug targets? Right? So what makes a good drug target? This is the first question that one would ask. Right? First requirement is potentially that it has to be essential for the pathogen. Right? If you knock it out, the pathogen is going to die. But then it should not be deleterious to human. You should not be accidentally knocking out human genes and so on and so forth. So we'll see what are all the constraints that we imposed. So we first started with all the proteins in tuberculosis, like 4,000 proteins, and filtered them out slowly here. Right? So we did some network analysis, similar to what I spoke yesterday, day before. Right? What are the node removals that cause maximum disruption in the network? So we ranked some of those nodes. Then we took flux balance analysis. There were, we had done FBA only for mycolic acid pathway, but a couple of groups had built whole genome, whole MTB models. So we used those models as well. And also some essentiality data from literature. Right, the paper which I was talking about a little earlier. So they did used a technique called transposon site hybridization mutagenesis, wherein they individually knocked down every gene from TB to get you the phenotypes. And the next step is you want to ensure dissimilarity with human. Because any target, you want to make sure that it's specific to TB and not to human. You would like to do this at the structural level. But obviously, data at the structural level is very limiting. You have only a few hundred, you have a few thousand structures, I think, or a few hundred. There are about 4,000 proteins in TB, and you have about less than 1,000 structures, right? So as proxy, we use sequence. So not sufficient sequence similarity. But we also tried structure, right, at least as a placeholder. So we took all proteins from TB which had structures. And for the remaining proteins, we predicted structures using a homology modeling engine. And for human as well, we did something similar. And we compared the geometry of pockets in each of these. Right? So any human protein which had, any TB protein which had sufficient similarity to a human protein, we threw it out. Okay, so that way, we kept culling this list till we ended up with a list of very high confidence targets. So we then looked at expression values, is the gene even expressed? And the other very important thing is similarity to gut flora proteins. Right? If you see, anytime you take antibiotics, I'm sure your doctor prescribes some vitamins and so on in parallel. That's because you're really hurting the gut. The gut microbiome is being extremely perturbed when you take antibiotics. And there are studies which shockingly show that the gut profile doesn't return to normal and even several months after administration of antibiotics, by which time you probably have your next dose of antibiotics in India. Right? So there are many challenges when you pick a drug, if you have to actually not hit any of these. You want to ensure dissimilarity to gut flora, ensure that no similarity to humans, and so on, human proteins and so on. So I already told you some of this, most of this stuff. We also classified them as broad spectrum and narrow spectrum, and TB has a uncanny knack to persist. They basically dormantly survive in the human body for a very long time, right? So can we target genes involved in persistence as well? So this is these are our various filters. So this is the sequence level filter, the structural filter. E is expression, G is gut flora, and I forgot what F is. So how do the known targets fare when you look at this? So we see several known targets have some structural similarities to human proteins, which could potentially explain some of the side effects even, right? And if you see some of the predicted targets are actually, have homology to gut flora and things like that. So they may end up being more broad spectrum than intended and could be a problem. Interestingly, most recently approved drug for TB. So I think they approved it in 2012, although the prediction was, the gene was proposed in 2005 or so. But it turns out that also, can pass through all our filters. So potentially that's, it's going to have lesser side effects or whatever. So overall, we came up with 450 targets, but coming up with targets is, is the zeroth step of the drug discovery pipeline, right? But although, invariably pharma companies do pick up targets from literature. Obviously, they prefer to pick it more from experimental studies than computational studies. But, if you could use computational methods to filter out experimental targets, which is in some sense what we've done, right? We have considered many targets which have from experimental studies as well, but filtered them out by looking at similarity to gut flora and so on. So this might help the heavy attrition that you see in drug discovery pipeline. Right? There's what's known as a late stage attrition. I don't know if you know the numbers. You start with 10,000 molecules, you might make one molecule, and in the process you spend a few billion dollars. Right? And the hardest part is you lose a lot in the end. Right, there are probably 20 molecules that survive in the 10th year or 5th year, but most of them get kicked out in clinical trials and things like that. And could you actually be more careful, more selective in your targets to hopefully have better chances of success at the later stages of the pipeline? So majority of the targets belong in metabolism and respiration and so on. And it includes many known targets and also that of the latest drug. I used to always say in my talks previously that the last drug for TB was discovered half a century ago. That was true till 2012. 2012, they approved this drug. But there was no drug approved for found for TB between 1950-odd and 2012. That's how tricky this pathogen is. But the main message of this last piece is actually not systems biology, it's structural biology. Right? You have to actually do structural comparisons. That will give you a much better insight into what's a good target. So that's about what I had to cover. So in the afternoon, we'll really get hands-on and work with the Cobra toolbox. And we can address some of these questions then as well. We'll try to compute synthetic lethals if possible, at least do some single gene deletion studies. What happens when you change the medium? I haven't given you some of the practical insights yet. How do you specify a medium for growth and take a look at different kinds of objective functions and things like that in the afternoon. So there are any questions, we can take them now or even after lunch, either ways. Perfect. So he's asking how do you come up with the coefficients for the objective function? So that's so here we essentially in a regular E. coli or something, what we do is we basically write out the entire composition of the cell. Right? It has some X amount of alanine, Y amount of adenine, Z amount of cytosine, X amount of some lipids, and so on. You take all of that in a particular proportion, because you need them in that kind of proportion to make the final biomass. So that the stoichiometric composition of the cell will determine these coefficients. That is tricky to find.
From biological literature, I've found out
So it's just like how they do it for like food and all that, right? Like for food, you know how proteins, carbohydrates, and so on, right? So similarly, but you have to fractionate it into the amino acids as well. So, but you can take some average compositions and like some leeway is there, and you can always use E. coli as some base reference, right? And you can, if you're a related organism, you can use this objective function, and. If you get some real discrepancies, some heavy discrepancies with data, then you may want to go back and really revisit your objective function, though. How do you?
Put in resistance.
So, for example, I think something we did here. No, I think that was another study. So the resistance is a big challenge. So one thing we tried to, I haven't talked about it here, but one thing we tried to do to tackle resistance was, there is a protein functional association network that underlies, you know, every organism. And somehow there is some communication that's happening from, you know, the target to the protein that actually mutates in resistance. Right? Or there's, you know, an SOS protein. There are like several mechanisms for resistance. There are cytochromes, there are SOS proteins, and so on. So we try to look at these pathways to see how you can potentially disrupt this network. Right? And it, I think now in the lab, they have some experimental evidence towards disrupting additional proteins alongside the original target. So we call them co-targets. So these are not essential proteins, but these are potentially proteins that are mediating the resistance pathways. So can you go and attack them in addition to the original drug targets so that it will kind of stifle the emergence of resistance? So we found that there are certain proteins that occur in multiple resistance pathways. Right? So those may be quite interesting. And I think, yeah, there was some RV0892 or something in TB, which this is what they've been working with recently in the lab, and they seem to have found success with that. So there again, so but my problem with most of these cocktail drugs is they are all targeting essential proteins, so there's a very strong selection pressure to evolve. Right, so if you could do this weak hit kind of thing, but again, that's still a lot more work needs to be done. No, nobody knows the answer to that. Resistance is like the biggest nightmare. That see, TB was forgotten by around 2005 when it emerged with a few more shocking traits. So there was so in UK it became a big problem in 2005. MDR-TB emerged heavily in UK. Now we are MDR-TB, XDR-TB, TDR-TB, and anti-TDR-TB. Multi-drug resistant, extensively drug resistant, totally drug resistant TB. And similarly, Staph aureus is not a lesser beast. So you have methicillin-resistant Staph aureus, vancomycin-resistant Staph aureus, Apparently, eradicating MRSA in UK hospitals was part of the election manifesto. So methicillin-resistant staph aureus is a nightmare in UK hospitals. You often have people who, you know, get admitted in the hospital for some treatment who succumb to an MRSA infection. It's a very hospital-based infection, strangely. Okay, I should be back early after lunch, so by even 2 or so. So you can, No, if you want to ask questions, we'll start the session at 2:30, but you are free to, you know. Oh yeah, for the long-term project and so on. So either way, yeah. Okay. Okay, so see you at 2:30.